Good morning, everybody. We're going to begin. We welcome you to a City Law Breakfast. I'm Professor Ross Sandler, and I welcome you all to this format. Those of you who have been to many of these breakfasts, I hope, and know that we often use the event center, but we're unable to do so today. So we're in this wonderful auditorium, which some of you may not have seen before, but is a very important asset of the law school. Let me call to the podium to start our Dean and President, Anthony Crowell.
Thanks so much, Ross. It is a great pleasure to welcome all of you here today for our first City Law Breakfast of the season, as we will call it. And it is a special moment because we are unveiling that first City Law Breakfast as the Center for New York City and State Law. We have for 30 years been the Center for New York City Law, which was founded by Ross. And we are adapting our format and our mission ever so slightly to embrace state law issues, which have such a profound impact on how the city operates. And the state has always loomed large in our programming, of course, but it's good to make a clear declaration of that. And it takes us into our fourth decade of service to this great city. And it is a proud part of our institution, as I said, that Ross created in 1994 when he arrived at the law school. And in honor of the great success of the center and the future of the center, Ross was named 2 weeks ago as the Samuel Seabury Professor of Law in honor of Samuel Seabury, who was an 1893 graduate of ours. And Ross is a scholar and a profound admirer of Seabury's work as an anti-corruption fighter and somebody who really put the state's interest above all. And he was one of the most consequential figures in the state's history, certainly in his work in crime fighting, but as a jurist on the Court of Appeals. He had a great meaning to the direction of not only New York City, New York State, but the nation in many of his heroic acts in public service. And so it's a great honor for me to have been able to appoint Ross to that position. And Ross continues on in his service as a leader of the Center for New York City and State Law as its founding director. I will be its faculty director. And we have a wonderful team who's joining us. And we've been amassing this team over the past year as we have put together the plans for the Center for New York City and State Law. And I want to just recognize program director and executive editor, Ben Max. Where's Ben? Ben has been an extraordinary new addition to New York Law School's team and has really helped to build some new elements, including bringing his well-known podcast, Max Politics, to the law school, and continues to educate our city and to really announce really what the civic, he helps define our civic sphere. We also have distinguished fellow and counsel to the center, Stephen Lewis, who recently joined us from the city law department, where he was a senior executive and chief of legal counsel for many years. I will also mention he was my boss for a number of years and a phenomenal mentor and is bringing great depth to the work that we will do. We also have our senior fellow and distinguished adjunct professor and director of the Census and Redistricting, Census Elections and Redistricting Institute, Jeff Weiss. Jeff, where are you? Thank you, Jeff. CityLand editor Veronica Rose, who's a graduate of the class of 2018. Veronica, are you? Veronica, I think, is outside. And then Rose White, who is our administrative coordinator. We also have appointed a number of senior fellows. I believe, too, if I miss anyone who is not here, I mean, I'm sorry, if I miss anyone who is here, but I know that we have Pepe Cheng de Castro, who is here. She is a senior fellow. Pepe is a graduate of the class of 2000 and recently served as deputy counsel to the governor. And Jim Karras, who is a longtime city legal counsel to the city council and is now a commissioner on the Commission on Ethics and Lobbying in Government. Hello, commissioner. Welcome. He was just appointed. I thought I would call him commissioner. And we look forward to engaging our other senior fellows. Senior fellows will help lead programs and mentor students, and it'll be great. So we were busy convening various meetings and programs over this semester and into the spring. And our next one will be next Thursday with Bradley Tusk to introduce his new book. And then Ben is organizing a policy briefing with City Planning Commission Chair Dan Gorodnick. So lots on the horizon. With that, I want to just ask Ross to come back up. Ross will give a more formal introduction to our wonderful speaker today, Deputy Mayor Ann Williams-Isom. When we were growing up, the superhero Hall of Justice, I think of her as one of those superheroes from that Hall of Justice. She has been leading extraordinarily complex and significant initiatives that affect the shape of our city and have such national impacts. And we're in awe of your service and grateful for you to be here to provide to shed some light and provide insight as to the direction of some of them. Ross, please come up. Thanks.
Thank you. We're delighted to have Ann Williams-Isom here, City Law Breakfast. She was born in Queens, raised by a mother who was an immigrant from Trinidad, a single mother and a nurse. She went to Catholic schools in Queens, graduated from Fordham University, where her first job after that was in the police department and then she went back to school at Fordham Law School, got her JD, worked at law firms as an associate at Robinson, Silverman, and Kalkinis Arkey, very important firms in the city. In 1996, she came back to the city to the Administration for Children's Services and stayed there for the next 13 years. In 1996, Nick Scopetto was the commissioner. He spoke here actually in 1997 of the difficulties he was facing with the Wilder decree and other problems at that time. Williams-Isom stayed at ACS for 13 years, rising to very senior levels, special counsel to the commissioner, ultimately deputy commissioner. In 2009, she left to go to the Harlem Children's Zone, where she was the chief operating officer. And then when Jeffrey Canada retired, became the chief executive officer. Most recently, she has been the James R. Dumpson Chair of Child Welfare. I remember James Dumpson, actually, and he was in the Wagner administration. And that's a great name and a great chair. In 2021, Mayor Adams brought Williams-Isom back to city as a deputy mayor in charge of health and social services, one of the most difficult jobs in all of government, and she brings her extensive experience and wisdom to that position. I looked at some of the things that she has said, and I found a wonderful series of quotes in the Fordham Alumni Magazine, if I may. In 2021, she was talking about the child welfare system. She said, "There are people who say you have to blow up the whole system because it's terrible and based on racist principles, and we can't fix it. Then there are people who are reformers like me. I call myself, I think this is a wonderful, an abolition curious person. I am kind of beginning to see it is not so easy to change systems and take out the years and years of racism in them." And then she further said that changes will take what are called radical empathy, which she defined as a kindred connection from a place of deep knowing that opens your spirit to the pain of another as they perceive it. We are delighted to welcome Deputy Mayor Ann Williams-Isom to the New York Law School podium.
I was riveted. I was like, who's that person? Radical empathy. I like that. Thank you so much. Very happy to be here this morning. It's moving to bring the names of some of my ancestors into the room. So when I first met Professor Sandler, you immediately said Nick Scapetta to me, and it reminded me how much I miss him. And especially at this moment when we need our mentors and we need wisdom and we need people to tell us we're okay and we've got everything that we need. You mentioned to me Kellis Parker, who was my professor, only Black professor at Columbia Law School when I was there. I met my husband at Columbia Law School. We took over the dean's office there at that time to protest that. I'm sorry, dean. It was, this first act of kind of, we wanted something different and were able to get other African-American professors there at the time. And then you mentioned James Dumpson, and a person who was in government, who was a teacher, who really, as I went back to Fordham, you want to do something? Come on. There you go.
Just can't pull the other keyboard.
Oh, okay. Y'all know I'm a Black woman. I use my hands. I do all kind of stuff. So I sit here really humbled, right, in this moment, because I'm supposed to be here at this moment dealing with really complex issues. I'm supposed to be in this moment when it seems like there's chaos all around us, bringing some light and bringing some calmness and looking people in the eye and saying, we're okay and we're gonna make it. And so all of those people who are looking at me down from heaven, I appreciate them and I appreciate you all inviting me here today. I was talking also about my sister, deputy mayors, and myself. We are running the New York City Marathon in 9 weeks, everybody. We always leave out Fabian, but Fabian is running too, the deputy mayor of communications, because it doesn't really work to say your sibling deputy mayors. I like to say sisters. But it reminds me again that in the midst of all that we're doing, right, we're moms, we are spouses, we are, you know, getting work done in the city, but we also know that we could really do hard things when we focus on it. So now we are training together to run this 26 miles and to have some fun and to connect with each other. It's one of the things that I've loved the most about this particular job is having a group of people who are public servants, who are dedicated and who are excited about the work that they did. This story about the asylum seeker crisis, and I've been trying to figure out whether I want to still call it a crisis or whether now we've moved to a humanitarian response, to me is a story of leadership. It's a story of leadership and it's a story of love. I am not, you heard my resume, I'm not an immigration specialist. I didn't come to this work because I thought MOIA, which is in my portfolio, the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs, was going to be the thing that I was going to be focused on the most, right? I have a child welfare background. We talked about me being an attorney at the Harlem Children's Zone. I worked with community-based organizations and early childhood and education, all of those things. But to be called upon with a challenge that is a completely different challenge that comes up quite surprisingly, I would say, right? The city has always had immigrants that have come here. But the first bus arrives and you're kind of like, where did this bus come from? What's going on? The second bus arrives and you're like, what's happening? And there were times in the early days, and I'm looking at Gary Jenkins, where we had 14 buses a day arriving and no place to put people. To me, that's kind of one of the key stories that I want you to take away from this. It's not that, oh my God, these migrants came and oh my God, we're doing this. It's the amount of time, it's the amount of people, and it's how we were not, that I would say Governor Abbott did it in order to create chaos. And I think he accomplished that, that there was a lot of chaos that was created at that particular time. We talk, and I wanted to put out this timeline a little bit because it's hard to believe it's been 2.5 years and that all of this happened and that we really from scratch, and I would say that we're still kind of flying the airplane and building it at the same time, decided what were the pieces that we need to do to make sure that people were safe, that people had a place to be. Those early days, people would get off the bus with no shoes on. Like it was bananas. You'd walk into, I guess we were at Grand Central, and there would just be people sitting there waiting to get placed. And you'd have the commissioner saying, okay, where do we have placements? But when we came into office, there were 45,000 people who were in the DHS system. And so we knew very quickly that that was not going to be enough. So finding places, the languages that people were speaking, making sure that we were getting the food that people needed, where families were gonna go. Just so that you know, right, as of right now,
The composition of the populations are about 35% are from Venezuela, 19% from Ecuador, about 9% from Colombia, 7% Guinea, and then we have the African countries, which are much smaller, even though when you look at, let's say, Randall's Island, there are many Black migrants there, and so we'll talk about what has been the difference or the challenges with Black migrants, Haiti, Mauritania, and Honduras. I say often that this has been a whole of city approach from the very beginning, even though it acts like the city is the only person who's been at the center of this. Again, I mentioned the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs, which is run by Manny Castro, who is a dreamer himself. The city has first, I don't even know, 6-7 years before de Blasio, probably in the Bloomberg administration, started the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs. So there was an infrastructure that was in place, CBOs that were funded, legal services that are funded, translation services that are funded. So it's not like New York City started from scratch. So we took all of that rich community and those rich resources and then had to build on top of that. So whether it was the faith-based community who stepped up, whether it was the CBOs, whether it was philanthropy, all right, philanthropy took a little time to get themselves together. And that was a little bit about, I think, politics, right? Because I think they didn't necessarily like the way the administration was talking about some of these. So we spent a lot of time with people dragging their feet, deciding if they wanted to step up and support us when it was really not about supporting the system. It was always about supporting our new arrivals. From the very beginning, the expense of it, as you all know, those of you who've gone through COVID or Sandy, at the beginning of a crisis, it's pretty expensive. You've got a start-up cost. You have to start from scratch. You're starting to hire people. There were, of course, people that we had from the city, but it wasn't like we had a group of people who were dedicated to this. Now we have thousands of people, lots who are contractors who are dedicated and working on this. I put a couple of this slide here to talk about something as simple as the arrival center. The arrival center is at the Roosevelt on 45th and Madison. And it is almost like the new Ellis Island. If you go in there, it is incredible to see how this is the place where when migrants come, this is the first place where they arrive. I'll tell you later about the triage that happens there, the medical, making sure that people are immunized, making sure that people are getting all of their vaccines, making sure that we can figure out where do people have family members, whether or not they want to be reticketed, right? Speaking of the Governor Abbott, he sent some people to New York that did not really, where New York wasn't their final destination. So we found very early on that there were people who wanted to be reticketed to other places. So that whole asylum seeker arrival center is run by H&H, our health and hospitals, which I'm trying to think about why we did that in the first place, but it was a brilliant idea to have people who are healthcare providers who are really focused on this, really work on those first, what we called HERCs, Humanitarian Emergency Response Centers. And then let me just say this little thing about, and I'll get to it, but Anna, stay here for a second. The right to shelter, right? I'm 10 minutes into this and I haven't talked about the right to shelter yet. So here in New York City, because we have the right to shelter, there were a lot of things, let's say regulations around what a shelter needed to look like, how close the beds needed to be to each other, how many bathrooms did you have to have? All of these regulations that are really important. But when you have 4,000 people coming in right away, we were like, I don't think we're gonna be able to do this. Something like being able to place everybody by 4 a.m. makes sense in the regular world. In an emergency, there were some things that just didn't make sense anymore. And so that was one of the reasons why we tried to create, I would call a parallel system where there would be other rules and regulations. And so the creation of the humanitarian and the HERCS and the humanitarian emergency response system was a way to be on this side of the ledger, so to speak, and not have to say we're in the DHS system where all of those regulations apply. Education as of now, and you know, we did it from the very beginning. I think we've had 40,000 young people who are in our school system at this time from the very beginning. And again, you all know all of the regulations that we have in the Department of Homeless Services in terms of how quickly kids need to be registered for school. And here we wanted to make sure that we did those same things. Case management and support, which was, we didn't have the application legal clinic that we have now. So we stood up a whole new clinic where we got volunteers from many people in this room and many people from around the city so that we could just start doing our own TPS applications, our work authorization applications. And remember, so I wish I had a slide at the time. We're doing this at the time when we're trying to also do advocacy, where we're trying to say, guys, we're taking all these people in, but we need more support from the White House. We need more support from the state. And everybody, I think for a very long time, was kind of like, this is your fault. These people are coming here because of you. And if you didn't have this right to shelter, people wouldn't be here. So you can't ask us now for money and support because you are the cause of this. And it's got to be something that you're doing, that there's people sleeping outside of such and such. And so it was a very interesting and I would say lonely period of time in those beginning of those days where everybody assumed it was that we were doing something wrong that caused this and really was like, what are you talking about, this humanitarian crisis and political unrest and climate change and slavery in moratoria and all these other kind of things? It doesn't make any sense. We continued and I talked about the public safety aspect of it, the advocacy. The self-sufficiency piece, I think, came a little later when we started to say people, I'll never forget this. In the early days, we thought that we would set up kind of these base camps where people would stay for a little bit of time until they figured out what they wanted to do next. It was never supposed to be long-term sheltering of people. And so very slowly, we started to realize that people were staying and people were like, nope, I'm really here. And this is where I wanted to settle. And so it's really started to then think about how would we connect people to resettlement? How would we connect people to work? Next slide, Anna. Just so that everybody is on the same page, as of today, September 12th, over 215,000 people have made their way to New York City. Over 150,000 of them have already gone on to their next stage of their journey. You all should be like, I'm surprised about that. And the reason you should be surprised is because I feel like nobody talks about it. The only thing that we talk about is the 62,000, maybe it's like 139, not that I'm counting, people who are in care today. So the people who are in care today is a tiny, tiny, tiny fraction of where we've been. And I say it's because of the combination of giving people some time here. And again, so I can't wait to get to questions, but I also want to say we've been in constant contact with our brothers and sisters in Chicago that's seen a lot of people come there, in Denver, who's seen a lot of people come there. And all of them, if you ask them how long they were giving people, it was like 2 weeks. We're going to give families with children 2 weeks. We're like, you're gonna give families with children 2 weeks. Like, how are people gonna get on their feet? We know that in Denver, there were families living under bridges. We know that in Chicago, there were people living on the street or living in police departments. We never had that here. I say it's because of the strength of the right to shelter, because of who we are as New Yorkers and what we believe in terms of what is acceptable to us and not, because of our safety net, because of that infrastructure that I told you that we were building on when we started. But people don't really talk about the fact that actually having some time limits and saying to people, this is temporary and we're going to support you and we're going to get you your IDNYC cards and we're going to get you connected to the application help center. But then we've got to figure out for those who can other places where they can be so that we can focus on the most vulnerable folks. Next, the cost. I haven't said it. You can imagine all of the things that I described to you is not cheap. And so, yes, we've spent $5 billion. We've also been able to save $2 billion as we've been able to, as I said to you, when you start off, things are much more expensive when you're in emergency mode, and we've been able to find some savings that has been very important. This slide I love because it talks about the fact that we've done 70,000 applications, 40,000 children I talked about, 100,000 medical visits, 700 people, asylum seekers connected to care, and over 75,000 vaccinations so that people can be safe and can be connected to medical care. I'll never forget one of the stories of when there was two stories. There were so many women who were coming to us in their ninth month of pregnancy who had never received any prenatal care. didn't have anything on those buses. When you think about taking that bus ride up here, maybe a sandwich, maybe some water, they were not treated humanely. And when they came here, this was the first time that they were able to get connected to services. I remember a seven-year-old whose epilepsy medicine was taken away at the border. And so literally when he stepped off of the bus here, had an epileptic attack that we were able to deal with. So many different kinds of medical concerns, obviously trauma. So Dr. Long does a screening for everyone at the Asylum Seeker Help Center. And it's, I feel silly saying it, to screen for trauma. Of course, everyone has some degree of trauma, but we're really trying to see who might be have a higher degree that needs to get connected to services right away. We forget about this now, but you all remember in the early days, we did have people committing suicide. We did have people who said, I don't want to be living in this hotel, even though there's another part of society that thought people were like living large. They're here, they're in a hotel. They're taking advantage of us. Aren't they happy? I don't know about any of you who've spent any time in a hotel room with your children. That is not where you want to be for the rest of, right? That is not, people are not coming here like, oh, this is the greatest thing ever. So people who committed suicide, people who have been under a lot of strain. Next slide. I would say when I look at the accomplishments, and it's kind of hard to look in the midst of it because it's been such a difficult time for all sorts of reasons. About, I don't know how long ago, maybe 6 months ago, I was invited by City Labs and my mentor, Linda Gibbs, to go to a conference in Paris where we were talking about immigration and what's been happening in cities. And it was eye-opening to me to see how many cities in Europe and Africa and all across the world are dealing with these same issues. Seeing how it's conflating now with issues of homelessness, seeing how it deals with how politically everybody is in the same place, which I will say is not a good place, and how politically hot and how much of a political football this has become, and to some degree has gotten us away from who we are and our values and what we know is important for migrants who have come here and who have been here the whole time. There was a story of a woman from, I believe it was from Senegal, and she talked about arriving in Paris and how, again, how her and her three-year-old or seven-year-old were living in under a bridge in somewhere in the middle of Paris. I got to tell you, I was shocked that that was the story that they wanted to tell at the conference as a good story, because she eventually did get housing. But here in New York City, we would never be highlighting a story about a mom and a three-year-old living someplace in a tent as something that was a good story. I think that the application center has been recognized nationally by the American Bar Association and others as a state of the art, unbelievable thing that we did. We take it for granted. We keep on going. We just, you know, going along with it, but it's an amazing thing to do that the amount of people that we have been able to get asylum applications, temporary work authorizations, and get themselves on the way to work. I think probably at a high cost to ourselves, the advocacy that we've done, and we can have a conversation about how much is too much and how much when you're doing your advocacy, you don't want to ever say anything bad about the migrants. It's never been about what the migrants are bad people or not good people. It's always been about we needed the support from the federal government, 40 years of bad policy, and still to this day, an inability to get for the congressional Republicans to get a bill signed that would help is ridiculous. And we find ourselves in the middle of all of that. And so I think that our advocacy as New York City made a difference to get some of those EOs. I will say, and I don't have the chart here, President Biden did his executive order in June, I think, of this year. And since then, the census and the amount of arrivals has gone down. So if I show you the chart and I show you from 4,000 people a week, we are now down to under 700 people who are arriving a week. And I know that's still, the mayor this past week at our off topics was like, 700 is still a lot. And I wanted to say, yes, brother, but it's not 4,000. And so from my point of view, finally, to have the exits be higher than the inflow makes a difference to us so that I can start closing. some of these shelters in people's neighborhoods that don't want it, so that I can stop focusing more on resettlement. So Jack Jiha, the OMB director, stopped looking at me like I'm stealing all his money, and that I can now put that money into, can we have some more money in order to do resettlement and connect people to work and really focus on preparing people for what they need to do. I think the advocacy for the state, I don't know if I should say this out loud, but I'm gonna say, I'm sure that they're like, okay, you have everything under control now. You don't need that $1 billion that we gave you. And so what level of advocacy do we have to continue to do to make sure, yes, we still do need those funds. We still have not, we've gotten a little bit money from the federal government, but not that much money. But again, the executive orders have really helped. In March of this year, we were able to come to a settlement with the Legal Aid Society around the right to shelter, so that we could officially do time limits for singles. And if you guys will remember, and you can ask me later if you care, Callahan, the case about Callahan is really about single adults. We never went into court about families with children, who, by the way, are, I have it somewhere, the majority of families in our care, people that we're taking care of are families with children. I want to tell you the exact. I will come back to it and find it. So singles is about 11,000 people who are singles right now. I would say probably about 5,000 adult families and about 48,000, and you can look it up for me, Ann, and tell me if I'm saying it right, families with children. So Callahan was always about the single adults and about being able to give them 30 days and that they can get an extension after 30 days if there are extenuating circumstances. So think about extenuating circumstances as reasonable accommodations, real ways that they are doing something. They're looking for a job. They are looking for housing. They're doing things to help themselves on their next part of their journey. So that helped a lot, being able to settle that. And let me say something about my brothers and sisters in the Legal Aid Society. I say this all the time. I don't know if Steve Banks and Josh Goldfein would claim me, but I claim them, because there was a time when no one cared about this issue. And when I needed to talk to somebody about how should I do this, how should I do that, it was them that I called. And we did not always agree, but that we were focused, that we cared about this population and we wanted to do the things that were best for them. So I do appreciate the fact that we have an advocacy community here in New York City that is relentless and that never lets you take a step backwards, but that behind the scenes can work in partnership to come up with real solutions. Do not tell Steve Banks, I just gave him a shout out. I think the challenges continue to be the challenges. We are a very dense city. So with 215 sites, right? If I even look at a neighborhood, somebody's like, nope, I barely want regular homeless people in my neighborhood. So I don't want, and I certainly don't want these migrants in my neighborhood. And so we're still dealing with that. I want to tell you, I've been disappointed in that, really. I mean, there's been some faith-based communities that I've seen that in the name of, you know, the Almighty have said that these people can't be here. And I'm continue to be shocked about the us and them. We can have a conversation whether we've contributed to that, and we can have a conversation about where we need to go now to move forward in order to make sure that we are integrating folks into communities. The global instability is still the global instability. I am happy that the numbers are down, but I'm nervous. Like, suppose what, I don't know what the election is gonna be in November, and will that make a difference? And will we find ourselves where we were before? Will we find ourselves in a different place? So that feels unsettling to not really know. I say to somebody, this is different than like a hurricane or something where you're like, you have the event and then you move on. This feels like we're constantly trying to figure out who's gonna do something crazy next and what is that gonna look like and what is New York City gonna have to do? And clearly the political discourse. This is one thing, and maybe I'll end here. I will tell you this right now. If you ask any New Yorker, or probably any of you in this room, so how do you think New York City has done in the migrant crisis? There are literally half of people who will say, I feel like you've given those migrants too much. You're giving them too much food. You're giving them too much housing. They're this and that or whatever. And then the other half will definitely look me in the face and say, you're not doing enough. I cannot believe that you're not doing X, Y, and Z, and that you're not getting that everybody has a job. And how come everybody doesn't have a housing right now? And everybody needs a City for HEPS voucher. And this is what you need to be doing, and that's the solution. I don't know if that's a sign that we're doing a good job, that everybody hates us and everybody thinks that we're not doing enough. But I know that this has been a time and a moment where you have to really look at ourselves as a leadership group and say, what do we think are the right things to do? No one's gonna like us. We're not gonna get any credit for it. Everybody hates us. I'm sure the White House hates us. I'm sure Kathy Hochul hates us. New Yorkers are very upset, but it doesn't matter. And when I think about my story of my mom coming here, and you said, you mentioned my mother this morning, who is 94 years old and who lives with me. She has lived with my husband and I. Oh, we're clapping for 94. All right, okay. I'll tell mom, we gave her, that we can tell, we gave her a shout out. She, her birthday is October 20th. She, when I left her this morning, it was early. So every morning I get up and I get her her English muffin. I get her her black coffee. I get her her orange juice. I bring the phone closer to her so she doesn't have to walk to the other room to get it. I make sure she's all set for the day. And so she'll say to me, am I gonna see you on TV today? I was like, I don't know. I don't know if you're gonna see me on TV today. But every day she has taken care of my husband and myself and my three children. She came to this country, the youngest of 14. Her mom died in childbirth. And so she was raised by the nuns in Trinidad and Tobago. So when I come to this moment, as the youngest daughter of a youngest daughter of an immigrant to this country, as a nurse, as a person who has dedicated her life to caring, I have to not every day be like, oh, this is terrible and people this or whatever. I have to go to sleep knowing that I'm doing good every day and go to sleep exhausted from doing good and just do the best that I can for this and for everything else that's in our portfolio and for this moment in time. I am grateful that I am the deputy mayor in this moment. I don't wake up and say, oh, I can't believe it. And this is not Eric Adams. This is not what I had in mind. It's not about Eric Adams. It's never been about Eric Adams. It's never been about any of that. It's been about being able to serve. And so when I come back and I'm like, this was not what I expected. It's a moment for leadership. It's a moment to lead the other people around me and to show them that we can do this and we can be okay. And it's the moment to open up my heart and to say that there is love enough for all of us and that the American dream 100% has room for all of us. Thank you very much.